This conference will now be recorded.
And let me share my screen. Okay, guys. So first of all, thank you everyone for joining today's session. So let me start with a few things. So first of all, thanks everyone who contributed to any of the charity for the COVID-19 cause. So I have like 40-50 names now. So I will share the details with you shortly. It's mostly been at the end of the May, the session regarding the AWS Certified Associate exam. The second thing is, last week someone gave me a good suggestion that because the heading or the main topic for this session is like cracking the DevOps interview, and rather than going with the approach where I'm going to tell you guys like, for example, this is AWS, I will again following the approach where we will start with some kind of a scenario, some kind of a question, and then go further. Okay, so rather than giving you a definition of like this is AWS and how it is work, I will start with a scenario which will be helpful for you during the interview session, or if you are writing any of the AWS exam, or just in your normal day-to-day job. Okay, so first thing, last time there is some confusion. I told you guys that I want to correct myself, because last time I told you guys related to the security group. Okay, and I said that security group works as a cumulative sum. With that, it means it does not work like a traditional firewall. And then I mentioned like, if you allow the port 22 and if you deny the port 22, it by default works as a sum and then it's going to deny it. And that statement is wrong. And honestly, like giving a wrong information to someone is like a crime for me. So just want to correct myself. With that, I mean, in security group, there's an implicit denial. And you can only allow things. Okay. So in case if you are, for example, your security group will like look like this, 122 or any port. So what security group will do, it's going to read this whole security group configuration at a one go and then apply the rule. So what I mean that in a case of a traditional firewall, it read the rule line by line. So first it read 22, then it read 80, then 122, 111. So security group does not work like this. It will read all the rule at one go and then apply the configuration. Just remember this point. So is that part is clear? Okay, I will take this as a yes. Okay, so like I mentioned earlier, today rather than going with a theoretical approach, I will come up with some of the question. I will wait for you guys to reply back to those questions or answer to those questions. And I will present those things in the form of a scenario rather than throwing you the like a definition, textbook kind of a definition. Okay, so let's work on the first scenario or the first question. So just give you brief ideas for all those people who did not attend the last session or who missed the last session. So in the last two sessions, we have created this VPC called MyTest VPC. The CIDR of this is this 10.0.0.16. Okay. This VPC has two subnets. One is called 10.1.0.24 and 10.2.0.24. One is called public subnet because it has a path to internet gateway. And second one is called a private subnet, which does not have a path to internet gateway. And after that, we have created two instances. One is called public server. And it has a private IP of this. So let's this one here. And it has a public IP of this one. Okay. So this is our scenario so far. Okay. Now, the interview question for you guys is, let's say I go here, go to action, instance state, and then stop this instance. Okay. So I'm trying to stop this instance and then try to, after that, after stopping that instance, I will start this instance back. How many of you think that this server will be able to retain this public IP? Okay, let me repeat this question. So I have this public server, which has this private IP and public IP. Okay, and let's involve private IP too. And I know this is just a basic question for all of you guys who are like, who is using AWS in your day-to-day life, or who is at least a AWS certified associate. This is a common question. So if I'm going to stop this instance and then start it back, how many of you think that this server will be able to retain its public IP as well as its private IP? Okay, I will pause for 30 seconds. Oh, sorry, I was talking mute. Can you please try to reply your answer via the Slack channel? Yeah, kernel is correct. Unless there's elastic IP, it cannot retain the public IP. Won't IP will change, public IP will change if you stop and start the instance. It will not retain the public IP, both the IP will change if you restart. I private I will be it not. Okay, so let's try that. Okay, so I'm stopping this instance. Okay, let's wait for this to be stopped. And in the meanwhile, can somebody answer this question? Why the I? Okay, so this is correct. The private IP will remain same, but the public IP will change. Does anybody know why the private IP will remain same and the public IP will change?
Public IP will change because it's unique and it's been supplied from the AWS's and pool. So once we release it, I mean, stop the instance, it will be released. So anybody can take the public IP. But private IP is like we can have multiple, like in this VPC we can have this private IP, in other VPC also we can have the same private IP. So private IP is local, but public IP is like in the internet domain. So
yeah, that
it
is,
gets released.
Absolutely correct. Yeah, thanks Nitish. Yeah, so let me, so as you can see that this instance, even after stopping it, it still have this private IP, but the public IP is gone. Okay, so let me refresh it just to make sure that I'm not giving you this detail from cache. So you'll see that 10.0.1.130 is still there, even in the stop state. Now, if I start this instance, okay, just to make sure that out of 99 times out of 100, you will not able to get the same IP. It's highly, highly unlikely that you will going to get the same IP. Okay, but there are odd cases where you will get, but like Nitish mentioned, yeah, he's absolutely correct, because that IP, that public IP will again go back to the Amazon pool of public IP. And anyone who spun up their server at that moment of time will get that IP. Okay, so this is one of the common questions which has been asked during the interview, that what will happen if I stop and start the instance? Okay, so now as you can see, the IP is different, the public IP, 34.213.107.70. Okay, so is that part is clear? I know you guys already know the answer, but just want to make sure that anyone who don't know it, this is the way. Okay, now just to make this scenario a little bit more complex, or just let me throw the second question based on the same scenario. So this time, rather than stopping and starting this instance, I'm going to reboot it. Okay, so let me reboot this instance. And remember that now we have this IP called 74. 107.71. How many of you think that this time when I'm rebooting the instance, remember, I'm not stopping and starting the instance. I'm rebooting the instance. I already rebooted it. How many of you think that this time this server has the same private IP? Okay, private IP, we all agree that it will remain the same. How many of you think after reboot, this server will have the same public IP? I will again pause for 30 seconds and I will wait for your answer. I mean, you guys already know, but okay. So let me answer this. Yes, the public IP will remain the same, but what is the reason behind that? Why it will remain the same? In case, what is the difference between a rebooting an instance and stopping and starting the instance? Because if you go back to the normal Linux philosophy, it appears to be the same. ENI is not detached. I don't think so, Kanan. Because even
so
in case of public IP.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Prashant, I think it will remain on the same hypervisor. So when we stop the instance, it will move on to a different, it might move on to a different hypervisor or a different machine in the AWS data center. But while we reboot, it will remain on the same machine. And so the IP will remain same.
Yeah, so you brought a very good point. So that's what I want to discuss it. So first time we stop and start the instance, we see that we got the different public IP. Right. This time we are restarting it, right? Or rebooting it, correct? Not restart, reboot. Right. And this time our public IP will remain the same. Okay. So, like you guys have mentioned, in case of stop and start, when we stop and starting the instance, the thing which AWS is doing behind the scene, because as you guys know, your instance is attached to some sort of a hypervisor, right? And mostly in case of AWS, mostly it's Xen. Now they are moving to like KVM or their new version, which is a mix between a Xen and a KVM, which is called Nitro, right? So what AWS is doing, whenever you are stopping and starting the instance, stopping and starting the instance, there, what AWS is doing behind the scene is moving this instance to some different hypervisor. Okay. But when you are going to reboot the instance, it is going to boot on the same hypervisor. And that's why you are getting the same IP address, public IP address. It is not leading to the public pool. Okay. So based on the same theory, then my next question is, if you go to this status check button, right, there are two kind of a status check. One is called system status check and second one is called instance status check. Anyone know what is the difference between a system status check and instance status check? And just to reiterate, this is related to the stop start versus reboot, or not say reboot, but at least it is related to stop and start in the instance. So just to give you more context, whenever you face any of the instance level issue, AWS support will say that, okay, check this instance check failure. Okay. And when there is a system check, status check, most of the cases we need to raise a ticket for the AWS support and then they will check at the hypervisor level. So again, okay, I will pause for 30 seconds again. And what is the difference between the system status check and instance status check? Yes, you guys are correct. So system status check is related to all these things. And the instance status check, I know this is one of the famous questions is like AWS SysOps exam. The difference between this system status check, like in which case you are going to check the instance status check versus the system status check. So, like this. Instance status check. Okay. So in case if there is any issue with on the hypervisor level, then you will see the system status check failure. But in case if there is some issue with your instance, for example, a simple case is most of you guys are aware of that fstep file, etc fstep file, and you somehow you added a wrong entry in that file and your system is not able to boot. Or the second scenario is, let's say you upgraded your kernel, the system kernel, and after that system is not booting properly. So in those cases, your instance status check is going to fail. So most of the time, what AWS support suggests in case of a system status check failure, where the underlying hypervisor is failing, just stop the instance and start it. So in that case, when you stop the instance and start it back, it will come back on some different hypervisor. And if it's a hypervisor level issue, then your issue will be resolved. But in case of an instance level check, you need to figure it out. So mostly there is a case, like for example, you can mount that root volume to some other system, fix the fstep file, or you boot your system into a runnable one to fix those kind of failures. Okay, that is clear to everyone? The difference between a system status check and instance status check, and difference between your public IP versus a private IP.
Yeah, Prashant, I would like to share one thing, like one scenario where I faced instance status check. So like for everybody. So once I was, when we were changing an instance type from M4 to M5 large, so at that time there is enhanced networking that we have to enable. So we have to make some changes in FSTAB and those files at kernel level. So once we did that, I think there was a some change, so instance was not rebooting after that. So at that point in time, we were having this instance status check failure. So we unmounted the ABS volume, attached it to another EC2, then made changes in the EC FSTEP file, and then remounted the root volume. So after that, it got corrected. So yeah, one scenario.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for sharing. I think there's a one really good talk by AWS support where they have mentioned how to do that. I will share it with you guys shortly. Okay, any other question or anyone want to share any of your scenario or any of the issue which they face related to this instance versus system status check?
Prashant, can we change private IP address of the server or any instance which we are launching after we are creating the EC2 instance? After that, is it possible to change the private IP address?
I never encountered that, but if you look at this VPC configuration, I think last time also we have discussed about this DHCP option set. So this is the DHCP options where you are getting the private IP address of your instances. Now there's a command called DH client, which you can run on that server. And most of the time, like again, this is a edge case. Most of the time you will get the same IP, but if you want to set up some kind of a lease, like a DHCP lease, which is another word called DORA, which is, I forget the acronym for that. But in that case, if that lease expires, then yes, you will get a different IP. But except for that, I don't think so there's any way to assign a different IP. Or other thing you can do, you can set up your own custom DHCP or DNS server. But I will not recommend you to do that. Is that answers your question? And there's a command called DH client, I guess.
Yes. Okay.
Okay. So far we have discussed, like, every time we are stopping and starting the instance, this IP is changed, the public IP. Okay. And if we are rebooting the instance, the public IP will remain the same. Okay. So now we want to build an application where even if we are stopping and starting the instance, the public IP will remain the same. And as you, some of you guys already know, the way to do it, that is with the help of something called Elastic IP. Okay. So let's try to allocate our Elastic IP to this server. So earlier this Elastic IP, I think it comes under this VPC, but now they have moved it here with, I mean, AWS one. So here you can see the public IP, which I have already allocated, is 54, this. So let me go to action, associate Elastic IP, choose an instance, and I'm assigning it to my public server. Okay. But before assigning it to my public server, let me go back. Okay. So let me give you another question or another scenario. So right now, forget about this private IP, or at least we know that this is not going to change. And we have this public IP, which is 74. I think we already noted on this, right? If I am going to allocate this Elastic IP to this server, okay, I'm creating one Elastic IP, okay, Elastic, and then allocating it to this instance. How many of you think that this server will retain this IP to the 74? Okay, so let me do that. I'm going here. Okay, I already have one Elastic IP. I'm going here, associate Elastic IP address, choosing the instance, public server, associate. Okay, so now I have allocated this Elastic IP or this public IP to my instance. If I go back to that instance, how many of you think that this server, that particular instance still have this IP? This is again scenario, or this is again one more interview question. I already show you, but what do you guys think, what happened behind the scene? Yes, it will not, but why? Yeah, as we can see that the public IP of that server is now being replaced with this Elastic IP. Okay, and that IP is now gone. Yes, no Kanan. So if the Elastic IP has been allocated to the instance at all the time, AWS will not charge you. But if it is not, then I think it's 0.05 cent per hour, something like that. Okay, but that's a different question. But tell me, guys, what happened? So now, just to make this thing a little bit more concrete, let me try to stop this instance. Okay, let copy this IP. So now, as you guys see, we have this IP allocated to this instance. Let me try to stop this instance now. And we know so far that when we stop that instance, that public IP is again go to the pool of AWS IP. And the next time when we are starting this instance, that is, we are starting into a different hypervisor, we are going to get a different IP. Okay. This time you will see this, right? And just to tell you one more thing, if you want to see, like, behind the scene, what exactly is happening, you can go here. I think yes, here. And there's something called get system log. So you will see that your system is right now is in the getting stopped. Just to tell you one thing, this is not real time. It's I think mostly what I learned based on my experience is, like, there's a 5 minute delay. So whatever you are seeing on your screen is not a real time. When I checked with AWS support, they said that the correct way to do that is, something called get instance screenshot. But that only you will get when the system is up and running. But that's an off topic, but you can see, like, if you want to see what your system is doing when you're stopping or starting it, you will see it like this. Okay. So now we stop this instance. But see, even after stopping that instance, that system did not lose its public IP. That public IP is still attached to that instance. Okay. Now let's start it. So as you can see, it does not leave or does not left that IP when we stopped it. So if we are going to start it again, it will not leave that IP, right? So that's the main aim of this Elastic IP, that it will stick to your ENI. Okay. And it will not go to the AWS pool of IP, even if you stop and start the instance. And earlier, I believe so, I don't know how many years back, you cannot bring your own IP. But now, AWS provide you a way that you can bring your own public IP to this. Okay. And just to tell you that I have never, sorry, let me ask you this question behind the scenes. Yeah, so Elastic IP is mapped to your ENI, and that's why it does not get released. Because this IP or this public IP will be associated with your AWS account, whereas the public IP which you are getting is from the AWS public pool of IP. If at this moment of time, if I'm going to release this IP, again, it will go back to the AWS pool of IP, and we will not get back the same instance. Okay, Kanan. Okay. So one thing I was telling you, I have never designed any architecture based on public this Elastic IP. I know few of my colleagues, they try to deploy an architecture where they rely on this Elastic IP. So what I mean is that, for example, if you are running an instance and you always want that instance to have the same public IP, they use the Elastic IP so that they will be absolutely sure, for example, if that instance goes down, they will move that Elastic IP to some other instance. Okay. But in that case, you will become that Elastic IP dependent. And you need some kind of your own custom script to do that failover. Rather than, my suggestion is use Route 53. So map your IP to a domain so that in case if the IP goes down or if that instance goes down, it's much easier for you to just to change that IP behind the scene for the domain name rather than changing the Elastic IP. Okay, that part is clear. So now if you can see that when the instance comes up, we have the same IP. Any question related to that? If not, then I have one more question related to Elastic IP, and then we will wrap it up and we'll move to the next topic. Any question related to Elastic IP? Okay, I will take it as a no. So now if you want to release the IP from this server, I will say disassociate Elastic IP. I'm disassociating it. Okay, so now it's not associated to any instance. I will go back here, refresh it. Now it will get its own public IP, which is again something different. And this time it gets from the Amazon pool of IP. Okay. If that part is clear, then there's one more interview question or one more scenario based question. So let's go back here. So far we have focused on this public server, right? We have this, and it has a public IP. Let's try to focus on the private server, because this is where most of the companies, for example, if I'm trying to build my database server or an application server, most of the time I'm going to put my private server or this kind of a server in the private subnet. Okay. So as you can see, this private server is only having this IP 10.0.2.108. Okay. With that means this server we cannot communicate it to the this server cannot communicate to the internet. And to show that, let me take this IP. Okay. Let me go here. Okay, because that's a private IP, I cannot communicate or I cannot log into that server directly. So first I need to log into my public server, which is having a public IP, and then I need to log into this server with having a private IP. This guy, unless or until I'm using VPN or other kind of a solution. Okay, so now I log into my this server which having a 2.1.0 IP. Now if I try to run this, okay. Now my question to you guys, how many of you think that I will be able to hit the google.com? Just to be clear, this server is in the private subnet.
Only if NAT gateway is attached.
Yes, NAT gateway is attached.
Or internet gateway.
Yep. So it will not be able to reach. Okay. Now, just to make this thing a bit different, let me go here. And last time you remember that we have associated our Elastic IP to our public server instance. Now let me allocate that Elastic IP to my private IP instance, which is 54F, right? 54F. So now I'm allocating this Elastic IP to this guy. Okay. If you go back here, now this private server is having this Elastic IP, 110. Now, how many of you think if I try to ping google.com here, it will be able to hit google.com? And if it is not, why? This server now have the public IP.
So it has a public IP, but it does not have any route to internet. So because it's in a private subnet, that's why.
Exactly. Yeah. That's the correct thing. Yeah. So yeah, even if we allocate a public IP to an instance and it doesn't know how to route that traffic to the internet, it will not be able to hit these servers. Correct. So let me do one thing. I will disassure the Elastic IP. Okay, I will leave it. I don't think I will be able to use it now. Okay, so this is all about this public IP and private IP. Okay, so now let me guys give you one more scenario based on this public and private IP stuff. So now this server, let me log in via root just to make my life easy. If I'm going to run this yum hyphen install, I think you guys already answered this question. Will it be able to reach to the internet and get the packet, this particular package? I think you guys already replied that it should not be, right? So what exactly I need to do to make sure that this guy, that this particular instance will reach to internet and get this packet or this package, Apache or whatever the package we want to download? I think somebody already answered this question, how to do that. Yep. So we need something called a NAT gateway. So what NAT gateway will do, it is going to translate your private IP to a public IP. Okay. And just want to emphasize on one more point, that NAT is only for your outbound traffic. That is the instance which is leaving from your instance. It is not for the inbound traffic to your instance. So that means your instance can communicate to the external world, but the external world cannot be able to communicate to your instance. That is one of the main features of the NAT gateway. Okay. So what we need to do, we need to add something called a NAT gateway. So to add a NAT gateway, come here, create NAT gateway. Okay. NAT gateway will lie on the public subnet because we need a way, a route to go to the outside world, which is the internet. So I will attach it to our public subnet. Here we need to allocate a EIP or Elastic IP to that instance. And name equal to NAT GW. Okay. Now one thing, let's try to do this. NAT gateway will take some time. So if you try to, okay, so one more thing which we need to do at this stage is tell our route table how to route this kind of a request. So you see that I have a two route table. One is called a public route table, which has the route to the internet gateway. The same way we need to tell our this private route table that, okay, if any request except 10.0.0 reaches to you, route it via the NAT gateway. Okay. And once again, I saw that many people, the moment they created this NAT gateway, they start hitting this command again. NAT gateway will take some time. Even if your status is showing as available over here, it might take some time. So just wait for a few minutes before try to execute this command again. If I try to execute this command at this point of time, I know it's going to fail because my NAT gateway is not available. Okay. So let's wait for this to be up and running, and then we will try to. But in the meanwhile, it is putting any question related to NetGate. I think it's pretty straightforward. And if you guys are using AWS for quite some time, you know that before the NetGate, there's something. Yeah.
I have a question. Why do you need an Elastic IP for NAT gateway?
Honestly, I don't know that. Yeah. I think it's just so. Because your NAT gateway also need one specific IP, which it cannot be allocated from that public IP pool.
Okay.
That's the reason, I think so, but you will see once it has been available, this Elastic IP is allocated to it.
Right, yeah, that's what I was wondering. Okay, no problem. Thanks.
Yeah, so you see this Elastic IP is allocated. If you run the command, one more time I'm telling you guys again, it will take some time. So the moment if it's available and you try to execute the command, it might fail. Okay, this time it works, but it will take some time for the NAT gateway to be up and running. And like I was saying earlier, if you are using AWS for quite some time, before this NAT gateway comes into picture, there's something called NAT instance, which does not exist anymore. But earlier, I think in 2014 and 2015, we used to use this NAT instance, and there's an AMI which is available in AWS Marketplace. And we need to spin up our own AWS instance using this AMI and need to manage our own instances. One of the advantage I can say that I utilize by using this NAT instance, that in the same NAT instance, I configure the Squid proxy, and I will be able to route or filter my traffic based on the Squid proxy, which I cannot do with the help of this NAT gateway. NAT gateway is fully managed service by AWS, and as you can see, we cannot do much on the top of it. If you go to this action, I can delete this NAT gateway or edit it. But NAT instance at that time, I configured my own Squid proxy, and whatever the request. So for example, right now, the moment I attach this NAT gateway, this is open for the entire internet. I can hit any website at this moment of time using this private IP or this private instance. But with the help of this NAT gateway plus NAT instance plus Squid proxy combination, I will be able to filter the traffic. But on the other hand, I need to manage this NAT instance. I need to manage that Squid proxy on top of it. But now this NAT gateway is a fully managed service by AWS. I don't need to do anything. I just need to do this click, one click and two click, and after that this service is up and running. Any question related to that NAT gateway?
Prashant, I just had a conceptual question. Like we have blocked traffic from incoming to our private IP, but once we we are installing any RPM package on Linux or from yum command, once we send a request, then we get the network packets, like the packages being downloading on our system. So isn't that like traffic coming into our private instance? How does that happen in the networking? I'm not sure.
So basically what exactly is this guy is doing? So if you come here, so we know that this is the private IP of the instance, right? And then we configured a NAT gateway where we have this IP. Like this part is clear, right? So now all of our requests are going via this route, right? So what exactly this NAT gateway is doing? So when this guy is forming the packet. So for example, I have used that command yum, and what yum command is going to do, you all know, right? It's based on your cd etc, or I can do this right. So based on whatever the repo we have configured on our server, which is present on here, right? It is going to contact any of these repo to get those packages, right? Any of these repo, this mirror list. So what NAT gateway is going to do, whenever the request is going from this source IP, okay, in the destination field, or in the source, earlier in the source IP field, it's going to change that source IP header from this IP to this IP. So that for the outside world, it is going to show that the request is originating from this IP. And same thing NAT gateway is doing intelligently. When the request comes back, it's going to answer to this IP. And again, when it is going to deliver to its instance, it's going to change the source IP header back again to 1.2.108. So for the outside world, does not have any idea about this instance. It only knows this IP. Is that answers your question?
Yes, now it's clear, yeah.
So I think enough about the NAT gateway. Let's move to the next topic or the next question. So now my next requirement is that I want to communicate I want to communicate to my S3 bucket. Let's start with the S3 bucket, which is the simplest scenario to determine or simplest scenario to demo. So I have this NAT gateway attached to it. And I said that the NAT gateway, you now have the full access to the internet. So if I am going to run this command, which is just the AWS command line, and I already have all the keys configured to this instance. Oh, wow. Okay, I think I have it on. With a different user. So I already have this access key, secret access key, region, and this configured. If I now run this command, AWS S3 LS, which is going to list out the bucket for my account, which is this, okay? And it is giving me the right output. Anybody know why it's giving me this output, or why, how I'm able to communicate to this S3 bucket? My second question is, what is the main drawback of using this approach? Okay, so let me repeat the question. I will again pause for 30 seconds after that. I am executing this command, and after executing this command, I'm trying to list my bucket. So it is giving me this bucket name, right, which is present in my account. And let me show you. If I go here, I have created this bucket, this guy. Okay, so it is able to list this bucket, which is absolutely fine. The second thing is, What is the drawback of this approach? Let me pause for 30 seconds. You guys are thinking in terms of roles and everything. For the time being, just think in terms of networking. Yeah, I mean, IAM policy and everything need to be attached, but just think in terms of networking right now, how it is able to communicate to the S3 bucket.
Maybe because of using endpoint.
Yes, exactly. That's what I want to hear. So, using the NAT, one thing is endpoint, and right now we have that NAT gateway attached to it, and that's why it is using that NAT gateway to go to the S3 bucket. You guys are absolutely right. We are using the IAM policy. We have those keys configured, and which is the wrong way. We need to attach the IAM role to it. Okay, so let me tell you one of the biggest drawback of that. And before coming to that, I think last time also we talked about it. So if you go to this AWS console, we have these different services like compute, storage, database, whatever it is. For us, AWS is showing this all this compute, storage in one place, right? But actually behind the scene, EC2 might lie in a different data center. S3, their service might lie in a different data center. So the correct term is it lies on the AWS public domain, which Nitish has mentioned, right? So in order for us to communicate to this public domain, if I try to communicate this server, so let me do one thing. We have attached the NAT gateway to this instance. So let me go back to NAT gateway. Okay. Let me delete that NAT gateway. Okay. And one more thing. If you now delete that NAT gateway and you go to the route table, you will see something. Okay. You will see something called a black hole. This will load. Now, how many of you think now I've deleted that NAT gateway, I will be able to reach to the S3 bucket? If I run this command, will it work?
Yes, it will work.
It will work in the private instance?
No, it will not. There is no route for internet.
Exactly. So NAT gateway is perfectly fine. Okay. But like I mentioned earlier, all these services, this EC2, S3, they lie in the AWS public domain. But at the end of the day, they are the part of the AWS network, right? Everything will be lies within the AWS data center. So earlier we took an example, like every company have a different data center. For example, at least we have a data center for QA environment, we have a dev environment, and we have the PRD environment. But if I want to push any change from our dev environment to the PRD environment, definitely I don't want to traverse that change to the public internet. And same thing applied to AWS. They don't want all these communication to be happen over the public internet. And that's why they come up with a concept called endpoint. What endpoint will do, so before that, if you go here, you will see something called a black hole because we have deleted that NAT gateway. So if that thing is not present, you will see something this black hole. And I think this is one of the famous questions for the AWS certified S3 exam. If the NAT gateway is not present, what will happen? So you will see the status as a black hole. So let me delete this guy. Okay. So now there's a concept of called something called an endpoint. what endpoint will do if now you see this hangs, right? Let me cancel this. What endpoint will do if from the EC2 instance, this guy, I want to communicate to the S3 bucket that whole traffic will not go to the internet, that whole traffic will remain within the AWS within the AWS network. It will never go to the internet. So for that, I need to create something called an endpoint. Okay. And you will see that it will list all the AWS services. And there are two kinds of endpoints. One is called interface endpoint. The second one is called gateway endpoint. We are going to discuss what is the difference between this. And if you go here, next page, there is this endpoint. And because it's a gateway, like last time you remember, we have that internet gateway concept. And what we do, we map that internet gateway to the route table. That, okay, if the request is for any other route except for the local VPC CIDR, we are going to route that request via the internet gateway. So same thing we need to do. First, we need to choose our VPC ID, which is this. And right now I know that for the instance which is in public subnet will be able to communicate to this endpoint, but I want my instance in private subnet to communicate to this server via this local endpoint. I can choose both. In this case, both my instance will be able to use the internal AWS route to communicate to that instance. So I choose both the route table. I will show you like what is the difference it is going to make once we add those entries. This is a policy. Just wait for a few minutes. I'm going to show you what are those policies. So right now you can think that I'm giving the full access to my S3 bucket. Okay. Action is star, effect is allow, resource is star, and principal is star. And I'm going to create this endpoint. So now the gateway endpoint is available. If I'm going to run this command again, it should work. Okay. Before going further, if you go here and see the route table, you will see it has both the subnet. And if you go to the route table, you will see that there's something added. That if the destination is this one, use this VPCE, which is stand for endpoint. It's been added to your private route table as well as this one. Okay. Now I have a question for you guys. If you will see that this route table has both the route, one is this route, one of this is VPC endpoint and one of this is internet gateway. So if I'm going to hit the S3 bucket, while logging to my public instance, which route it's going to follow? It's going to follow this VPC endpoint route or it's going to follow the internet gateway route? And in both the way, we will be able to reach to our S3 bucket. But which route it's going to follow? Yes, you guys are correct. So it's going to follow this VPC endpoint route. And the reason for that in AWS, if you have some specific route defined, or explicitly if you define a route, AWS is always going to follow that route. Okay. So when we created that endpoint, we have seen something called a policies. Okay. So at that stage, I told you just okay. Let's go to the endpoint one more time. This policy. So this policy we have given star dot star. Okay. But what would be the case if I want this endpoint will be able to talk to only to my specific S3 bucket? So in that case, we can specify a policy. So for example, I can specify this policy that only the get and put object and only to my S3 bucket, the specific S3 bucket, I can specify it over here. Okay. I can even specify to this, for example, if it's want to communicate to this other endpoint, or I can even use the S3 bucket policy where I can define this VPC endpoint. So let me show you. This one is interesting. And if I signed the NDA with AWS, but I wrote that AWS security specialty exam, and in that there's one question related to this, where they have given you this policy and you need to troubleshoot it. So what exactly this will do, if you go to the S3, go to S3, permission, bucket policy, okay. Let me copy this, I need to give my bucket name here. The font size is too small. Let me increase it. Okay, same thing here. So let me copy paste this and then I will tell you what exactly I was doing. This endpoint. So any one of you guys who is preparing for that AWS security exam, just remember this point. Or even if you're in your daily job. So what exactly I'm trying to do, I'm trying that if any request is coming except this VPC endpoint, deny it. So let me save it. Okay. What is the invalid resource?
The extra space over there for resource, first one.
Oh yes, thank you. Okay, let me save it. See, now after applying this policy, what I said that I will be only able to access this bucket from this VPC endpoint. Now if I try to access this bucket now, I will get the access denied. Okay, but if I go back to my console and try to access this bucket, oh man, connection timed out. Okay. Oh man. Okay. So I need to go back to my console. And if I try to access this, it should work. So now what I did, that my S3 bucket will only be accessible from my endpoint, not via, even via UI. So I blocked the other user even to access this S3 bucket. So this is what I used to do for a highly secured bucket in my environment, that I want this to be only accessible from my instance, not from any other place. Okay, is that part is clear? Any question related to the VPC endpoint? I mean the gateway one.
Prashant, just where did you attach that policy? Is that a bucket policy or in the endpoint?
Yeah, the policy. That's the bucket policy. So okay. Here.
Okay, fine.
So Prashant, so if you want to change the policy back, only the admins can do it, or the root account can do it?
So now what exactly you need to do? You need to do it only via the CLI. There's no way you can modify the policy via the
Okay, and then so you can access through.
Okay. Yes. Any other question related to that? And I already pinged you guys a doc where it's a pretty good doc. I always follow this doc while defining all these policies. So it has a bunch of examples which you can see how you can define policy for the different endpoints. Any other question? Okay, so this is gateway endpoint. There's one more endpoint which is called a interface endpoint. Okay, I don't know what is the reason behind that, but for gateway endpoint, AWS supports only two kind of endpoint for two services. One is S3, and second one is called DynamoDB. If you go here, you will see that the gateway endpoint is available for DynamoDB as well as for S3. And once again, if any one of you preparing for the AWS certified Assured exam, this is one of the common questions, like gateway endpoint is available for which services? One is S3 and one is DynamoDB. But there is a second thing which is called interface endpoint. And for the rest of the services, all these, they have this interface endpoint. And I think one of the reason behind that, because later stage AWS come up with something called private link. And all these interface endpoint under the hood using the private link. Okay. And let's talk about that. So this is again one of the interview questions, like what is the difference between a gateway endpoint and the interface endpoint. Can anyone wants to pitch in and talk about that? What is the difference between a gateway endpoint and the VPC endpoint or the interface endpoint? What is the major difference between those? I already mentioned one difference, that gateway endpoint is only for S3 and DynamoDB, and for most of the rest of the services, we have this interface endpoint. Anyone else wants to speak about it? It's already 9:04, guys.
Okay, so for like gateway endpoint, we had to make an entry in the route table, but interface endpoint, I think it's using private link, which is like an AWS intranet on which or mm-hmm. through which all which internally it will communicate with the services. So we are leveraging that intranet of AWS, maybe.
Yes. Yeah. And interface, as the name suggests, it's based on the ENI level, which is your Elastic Network Interface. And the last session also, I told you guys, there's one more thing which is mapped to your ENI, not to your instance. What was that?
Security group.
Exactly.
Security group.
Thank you guys, at least you guys remember that. So interface endpoint is mapped to your ENI. So let's try to show you. So I think if you remember last time, I told you guys the way we are using the CloudWatch log. So basically from our instance, which lies on the private subnet or in the private VPC, we need a way to push those logs to our CloudWatch log. And for that purpose, I'm using this CloudWatch logs interface endpoint heavily, so that this will, all of my logs, which are my system logs or the application logs, which will not traverse to the internet. Okay. So for that, I will enable this interface endpoint. Okay. And I will put it on my VPC. If my internet allows.
Prashant, we are not seeing your screen. I think it's frozen. Or maybe it's on the notepad.
No, I guess it's again some internet issues. Just give me a minute.